to Old Greenwich Presbyterian Church. My name is Barb Frinzy, and I'm very excited and happy to be here today. It's a real important day in the life and the history of our church. I have a few announcements to make before we get our service started. We are collecting children's pajamas through the 20th of December, so you can drop them off here. And if anyone in the congregation is in need of any help with presents or food, the community outreach will be glad to help you. Please contact Sharon Smith confidentially, and she will help you get what you need. Also, on December 20th, the video will be out of the intergenerational pageant, so that will be exciting. And today, notice is hereby given that the annual meeting, part one, of the Congregation and Religious Corporation of the First Presbyterian Church of Greenwich Township in the County of Warren will be held today following the 10 o'clock service of worship in various virtual formats. Following the service of worship, there'll be an opportunity to greet and question our new pastor, Mary Beth Mardis-LeCroy, via Zoom meeting. The approximate time of that is 11:30 to 12 o'clock. And the purpose of the meeting is to vote on the revised bylaws of the congregation, hear the report of the nominating committee, and to vote on said report. Nominees of the Office for Elder and Deacon, Audit and Nominating Committees will also be presented. Then we'll vote to accept the Reverend Mary Beth Mardis-LeCroy as our new pastor. We'll also vote on the terms of call for the new pastor, which is actually the financial and benefit package, and then to dissolve the pastor nominating committee. And that's by Lisa Gray, our clerk of session. And I would like to give a short, brief introduction to our new pastor who's gonna lead our worship service today, the Reverend Mary Beth Mardis-LeCroy, who is currently in Iowa. She will be virtual with us live after the service. She did ask me to say to all of you how very excited she is to be worshiping with us today and hopefully for many years to come. Mary Beth grew up mostly in South Carolina, has lived in several other places throughout her life. Her dad was in the Army when she was very young, so they did move around. She attended high school in New Hampshire and then went on to Yale University and majored in French. After earning her BA from Yale, she lived in France for a year during college. She then came back home and attended Princeton Theological Seminary and graduated in 2005, and that's where she met her husband, Matt, who's also a minister, and they moved to Des Moines and got married later that month. She's been in Iowa since then. When she first got there, she served as associate pastor for the spiritual development at Westminster Presbyterian Church for 3.5 years. And then she served as a chaplain with Hospice of Central Iowa for 2 years. Since then, Pastor Mary Beth comes directly from St. Paul's UCC Church of Christ in Madrid, Iowa, which is near Des Moines, and she's been there for almost 10 years. She and her husband, Matt, have 3 children, a daughter, Ellie, who's 10, Will, who is 6, and a new baby boy, Calvin, who's now 2 months old. And they also have a cat. So she's very excited to be here. Please join us after the service today, which is going to be on YouTube, of course, you'll see us, and then via Zoom. The links have been sent to you. She will be live, Pastor Mary Beth, for about a half an hour prior to our meeting, where you can ask any questions that you may have prior to the vote. At that time, she will leave the meeting. We'll do all our business, and she'll come back in at the end after we have elected and nominated her to be our new pastor, and then we'll have a short fellowship following that for about a half hour where you can introduce yourselves and welcome her. So thank you. On behalf of the PNC, we're so excited. Mary Beth really is an outstanding pastor. We as a committee reviewed more than 225 candidates, and she's the one that came out on top. And she's especially good at worship, music, with the youth group and pastoral care. So we hope you will love her as much as we do, and we look forward to all of you meeting her today. Well, thank you.
Good morning. We're the Ahar DiGiovanni family, and we're here to celebrate the third Sunday in Advent, which is joy. Watch and wait for Christ's coming, like candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God with prayer. We light this candle in hope. We light this candle for peace. We light this candle in joy.
Rejoice. Hear these words from the Philippians, verses 4 through 5. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. Let the Lord is near.
Joy is the eager anticipation about wonderful things to come. The shepherds experienced this as they ran to Bethlehem to see Jesus. Let us pray. Our joy isn't dependent on what is going on in our life, in our world, or the people that we are with. It doesn't depend on the gifts we give or the gifts we find under the tree. No earthly thing can ever give us complete joy. Our joy comes from you. That joy that flooded the hearts of the shepherds, the angels, the wise men, the hosts of heaven, and Mary and Joseph is the joy that still has the power to overwhelm our hearts with rejoicing.
Good morning. I'm Charlie Frinzi, and I'm very happy to be part of this special service today. Here in this place, we discover the great things God has done. In story and song, in silence and sacrament, we are reminded that God's relationship with us lasts forever. Here with these people, we find our true home, where we can run home laughing after being lost for so long. Here during this holy season, we hear those promises made so long ago of the one who repairs all our mistakes, of the one who reshapes our brokenness. Let us come together to worship. We are joyful today, Lord, not only for the coming of your Son, but also for the joy of hearing Pastor Mary Beth. This season of Advent is upon us, and we have felt your love through it all. Increase our love for one another and for you. Instill in our hearts the hope of our salvation, and surround each one of us with your love and joy. We ask this in Jesus' name. Truth about ourselves, joining in our prayer of confession. Lord God, we praise you for sending light into this world. We confess that we live as though the light had never defeated darkness. We confess that we ignore the Savior you sent to be among us and to live in us. We've kept the birth of your Son confined to the Christmas season and do not yearn for his coming each moment in our waiting hearts. Forgive us for not opening our eyes to Jesus. Prepare us for his return. Help us rejoice in the light so that your grace can illuminate the darkened places of our hearts. Amen.
Hear this, people of God. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's love for us. As far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our sin from us. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We are set free. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen. I like stories. Do y'all like stories?
We do.
Did you know that stories are an important part of our faith?
Yep. Our Bible is full of stories of God's people.
Like the story of Adam and Eve in the garden?
Or the story of Moses, Miriam, and Aaron leading God's people to the promised land?
Or the story of Jesus' birth?
These stories tell us so much about what it means to be God's people. They show us God's deeds of love, God's actions for justice, and God's longing for peace for all of us.
Yes, all of us. The thing about stories is that we've all got them.
We've all got them.
As God's people, just like our ancestors in the Bible, we've also got stories about how God works in our lives.
That's right, and sometimes we tell those stories out loud to one another.
The fancy word for that is giving testimony.
Giving a testimony. That's when we tell our own stories about how God works in our everyday lives.
How we see God showing up, giving us peace, giving us direction, inspiring us to love.
And you know, we can't keep these stories to ourselves.
That's one of the reasons we have church, so we can tell our faith stories to one another.
So our stories can be heard and heard again.
So we can all keep reminding ourselves that God is real, that God is alive, that God is moving in all of our lives, separately and together.
Uh-oh, I feel a song coming on.
It's an oldie but goodie. I love to tell the story. Can y'all sing it with me?
I don't know.
We'll try. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it is true. It satisfies my longing.
Let us pray. Speak to us, Lord. Speak to us in the waiting, the watching, the hoping, the longing, the sorrow, the sighing, and the rejoicing. Speak to us by your word in these Advent days, and walk with us until the day of your coming. Amen. Hear the word of the Lord from Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 4 and 8 through 11. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to release the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among many peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are the people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with a robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, I'm singing all is bright. Tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace. Oh, sleep in heavenly peace. Shepherds crave, oh, at the sight, glory stream from heaven afar. Savior is born. Oh, Christ the Savior is born. Oh, now my Lord, oh, now my Lord, he is born, oh, now my Lord, oh, now my Lord. He is born. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love your light. Oh, now radiant beams from thy holy face, oh, with the dawn of redeeming grace, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, oh, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. He is born, oh, now my Lord, oh, now my Lord, he is born, amen.
Our second reading for this morning comes from the Gospel according to John. We're reading from John chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, and then skipping down to verses 19 through 28. Listen here for God's word to God's people. Now there was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah. I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I'm not." And they said, "Are you a prophet?" And he answered, "No." And then they said to him, "Who are you? Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? And John said, I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said. Now, they had been sent from the Pharisees, and they asked him, why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet? John answered them, I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal. This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Old Greenwich Presbyterian Church, let's talk about testimony. I come from a long line of Presbyterians and Presbyterian pastors. This is on my mom's side of the family. Her granddaddy was a Presbyterian pastor, and his daddy was before him, and his daddy was before him, and on it goes. So it makes sense that my sister and I were raised in this tradition, in the tradition of, you guessed it, being Presbyterian, very Presbyterian. But my dad's side of the family, now that's a different story. My dad's side of the family is the Southern Baptist side of the family. My dad's family is from Georgia, from North Georgia. And I remember when my sister and I, when we were younger, we'd visit my grandparents. These are my dad's parents. We'd visit them in the small town of Carnesville in Georgia. And we'd almost always go to church with them. If we were there for Sunday evening, we would go to church with them. It was prayer meeting time in the Southern Baptist tradition, prayer meeting time. And I remember worshiping with my grandparents on those Sunday nights. And I remember watching, a little confused, as one by one, the saints of the church would do something that did not seem very Presbyterian at all. They would stand up and they would share something personal about their life, something about where they saw God working in the middle of their everyday, mundane existence. I just want to give glory to God for my new hip, which has eased my pain so well. Thank you, Jesus, one would say. Or another would say something like, I ask for your prayers. My grandson has wandered far into sin, but I know the Lord has a plan for that boy. These folks would talk very specifically about what God was doing. What God was doing among their family members, in their jobs, through their various medical ailments. No topic ever seemed too big or too small. One person would share about a conflict in a far-off nation, and the next would share about her doctor's advice to cut back on salt. And no matter the topic, no matter the story, they always made time to share them. Now for some of us decent and in order Presbyterians, giving testimony may seem a little scary, a little out of our comfort zones. But what is it really? What is giving testimony? Well, giving testimony is just another way of saying, telling your story. It's just another way to say, tell your story. It's telling your story. Giving testimony is telling your story about how God is working in your life. It's telling the story about how God has shown up, how God is moving, how God is real for you. Giving testimony, sharing your story, is a beautiful and brave way to witness to the work and grace of Jesus Christ in our lives. There is something powerful, something sacred in testimony. Some of you all know how much I love music. You've maybe heard by now and realize how much I love music. One of my very favorite musicians is the late and great Johnny Cash, the country singer Johnny Cash. One night at a concert many, many years ago, this is right before he was about to step on the stage and begin his first set. Johnny was recorded saying, "Get off the stage, Cash. Get off the stage, Cash." I love that. Get off the stage. A spiritual man himself. I think what Johnny Cash is doing in this moment is reminding himself to get out of the way, get off the stage, get out of the way, and let something bigger, something better, dare I say something more holy, use him and work through him. The singer is trying to point not to himself, but to the source of his song. The singer is trying to point not to himself, but to the source of his song. Now, I think that John the Baptist, is trying to do something very similar in our scripture reading from this morning, from the Gospel of John chapter 1. In our scripture lesson for this morning, we see John the Baptist, who also is spending his life trying to do just that, trying to point to something bigger, something better, something more holy than he is. There was a man sent from God whose name was John, the gospel begins. Now, you all may remember from your Sunday school days that John the Baptist is a cousin of Jesus, right? You remember that? He's a cousin of Jesus. And like his cuz, he's a pretty charismatic figure, that John the Baptist. He's pretty charismatic. And so he's preaching, he's teaching, he's baptizing all over the place, all over the wilderness. And he's apparently drawn quite a collection of followers, quite a collection of followers. So one could be forgiven for thinking that John might be the Messiah himself. But the gospel writer is quick to put that suspicion to rest. John came as a witness to the light, the gospel writer says, a witness to the light, to testify to the light. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. Still, though, the people wonder, "Who are you?" the priests and the Levites ask him. "I'm not the Messiah. I'm not the Messiah," he replies. They aren't convinced. "Are you a prophet then?" "No," he answers simply. "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" And John says, "I baptize with water, and among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." There's a painting of the crucifixion by the German Renaissance artist Matthias Grunewald. The center of the painting is, of course, the crucified Christ, right? Christ on the cross, that's the center. But off to one side stands John the Baptist. Off to one side is John the Baptist. His long, bony finger points away from himself and towards Jesus, towards the cross, towards Jesus, as if to say, "Look at him, not me. Look at him. Look at him." That's who John is. That's who John is. His life's work is to serve not himself, not his own needs. He doesn't want to prop himself up. He doesn't want to polish his resume or burnish his credentials. He doesn't want to be the expert in the room or the one with all the answers. But all he wants to do is to bear witness to Jesus Christ. That's what he's there for, to bear witness to Jesus Christ. That's his testimony. That's his testimony. That's his story. And he's sticking with it. There's something powerful, something sacred in testimony. Are you nervous yet? Are you nervous? Don't be. Don't be. I'm not planning on starting a Sunday night testimony meeting, prayer meeting, anytime soon. But people of God, as we begin our work and our witness together, I wonder what it would be like. I wonder what it would be like if this church were a place that we learned to speak and to listen to the sacred stories about what God is doing among us in big ways and in small ones. What might it be like to bear witness to Christ? What might it be like to bear witness to Christ in the particularities of our own lives? And what would it be like if we did it out loud and we did it together? What would it be like? Because church, there really is something powerful, something sacred in testimony. There have been a lot of churches in my life. One of them was Plymouth Church, where my husband pastored in Des Moines, Iowa for about 15 years. And a couple of years ago, a member of that church, a member of Plymouth, who was a friend of mine, was struggling. My friend was struggling. An only child, he was living in the grief and helplessness as his father succumbed to Alzheimer's disease. And part of what made it so hard for him was watching the strain that this caregiving for his father put on his mother, right? His father's wife. It put so much strain on her, and it was so hard for him to watch that. People didn't want to talk about it with her. Sidebar here, it seems to me that caregivers often suffer in silence, as if their loved one has not just a disease, but a curse. Anyway, my friend is brave, and he decided to break that silence. He broke out of it, he broke the silence, and he decided to share his struggle with a few people in the church whom he trusted. And together, my friend and these other faithful folks, they hit upon an idea. What if there was a time and a place that was set aside for caregivers to gather with each other and for the ones that they were caring for, not exactly as a support group, but as something more casual, something more social? What if they could create a place where they could be in the presence of other people who understood, people who would not bat an eye at an odd comment or a strange interruption or the decision to get up and walk around the room? They called it Memory Cafe. Memory Cafe. One Friday a month in the church coffee shop, they would gather together, knowing that they were surrounded by others who got it. They were surrounded by others who got it, who understood. Now, it sounds like such a small thing, and maybe it is. Maybe it is, but it helped. Memory Cafe helped. It healed. It made the days just a little easier for some of those caregivers, my friend included. And it all began with my friend telling his truth, telling his story. It all began with my friend sharing his testimony. Testimony doesn't have to be dramatic or earth-shaking or entertaining. It just has to be true. It just has to be true. When we learn to share our stories, when we start to see where God is showing up in our lives, and then bravely, because it does take a lot of courage, to articulate that to others, when we learn to bravely articulate it to others, when we learn how to listen and how to receive the testimony of our siblings in the church, when we bear witness of Christ together, when we bear witness to Christ together, something breaks open, church. Something breaks open. It helps. It heals. It makes our days just a little easier. And it all begins with our telling our truth, with telling our story. It all begins with giving our testimony. Old Greenwich Presbyterian Church, I don't have a 5-year plan or a strategic vision to offer you this morning, praise Jesus. But I do have a wondering. I do have a wondering. What if we, as a church, grew in the sacred ability to tell our stories, to speak and to listen, to bravely discover the power of testimony together? What if we could do that? Wouldn't that be something? Thanks be to God. Amen. For this week's prayer of intercession, we're going to enter into a very ancient prayer. This is a prayer, was a prayer that was prayed as early as the 8th century, and maybe even before that, during the season of Advent. It's often called in English the O Antiphons. Interestingly, the hymn, O Come, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, is based on this very ancient prayer. When you all hear me say, so we pray, I invite you to respond, Come, Lord Jesus, from wherever you are. I know many of you are watching this online. It doesn't matter. From wherever you are, when I say, so we pray, I invite you to say, Come, Lord Jesus. Let us pray. O wisdom, coming forth from the mouth of the Most High, pervading and permeating all creation, you order all things with strength and gentleness. Come now and teach us the way to salvation, so we pray, Come, Lord Jesus. O Adonai, ruler of the house of Israel, you appeared in the burning bush to Moses and gave your people the law on Sinai. Come with outstretched arm to save us, so we pray, Come, Lord Jesus. O root of Jesse, rising as a sign for all the peoples, before you earthly rulers will keep silent, and nations will give you honor. Come quickly to deliver us. So we pray, Come, Lord Jesus. O key of David, scepter over the house of Israel, you open and no one can close. You close and no one can open. Come to set free the prisoners who live in darkness and in the shadow of death. So we pray, Come, Lord Jesus. O radiant dawn, splendor of eternal light, Son of justice, come and shine on those who live in darkness and in the shadow of death. So we pray, Come, Lord Jesus. O Emmanuel, our sovereign and lawgiver, desire of the nations and savior of all, come and save us, O Lord our God. So we pray, Come, Lord Jesus. God of grace, ever faithful to your promises, the earth rejoices in hope of our Savior's coming and looks forward with longing to Christ's return at the end of time. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus, the one who is coming, the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Advent is our season to wait, and to watch, and to hope. But hope is more than a feeling. It's more than a feeling, it's an action. It's an action that we can take by sharing our blessings with this whole wide world. So let us do that, church. Let us worship God with our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Loving Christ, we give you thanks that you are our light in the darkness, our hope in the deepest part of the night. And though the night may be long, we give you thanks that joy always comes in the morning. As we wait, as we watch, as we hope, as we tell our stories, we pray that you would prepare us for your coming. Take now these gifts that we give back to you, that they may show forth your love to this whole wide world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God sends us into the world full of hope and good news for God's broken people. In that assurance, as we go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you and sustain you this day and always. Amen.
I was a wandering soul, traveling the world-worn road, a sinner so far from home, no second chance in sight. I heard you call my name, I felt you lift my shame, and I made a vow that day I'd spend the rest of my life loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. I pray the whole world hears the cry of my heart to see all the ones I love loving my Jesus. Sin tries to make you hide, whisper the same old lie, keep all your pain inside, 'cause no one will understand. The last thing that this world needs, someone I'm trying to be. Truth has set me free. I'm just a broken man, loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story of how mercy. all is said and done, when my last song's been sung, I stand face with the one who gave all for me. May all I have to show be all that mattered most, making your great name known. Let this be my only legacy, loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole world hears the cry of my heart, is to see all the ones I love, the ones I love, loving my Jesus.